This is me, Jordi Casamitjana. I'm the Campaigns and Enforcement Manager at IFAW UK. And I deal with the domestic issues, basically the animal issue that has to do with Great Britain. There are other campaigners in my office that deal with other international issues. And we'll be talking about what I do. But before getting exactly my part of my work in here in the UK, I'll introduce about the work that we do in IFAW in general. So the first 5 minutes is about IFAW in general, what we do in the world. Then we'll go into the UK and then into what I do. This is basically it. IFAW was founded in 1969. We have 15 offices in the world with projects over 40 countries. All these orange bits are countries that we have an office. You see, we kind of well covered the areas like Latin America where we don't have an office, but we do have projects over there. And these are the offices we have. So some of them are in kind of unusual countries, China. Many few organizations, Western organizations, have an office there, or the United Arab Emirates as well. So we're kind of diverse, and we reach places when some others can't, which is good. So it's good to have it. This is our vision, so a world where animals are respected and protected, which, of course, is the vision that probably you all share with us. And our mission is rescue and protect animals around the world. So we're not limited geographically. We can do it anywhere. And we rescue individual animals. It's as much as the individual as is the species as is the community. So we protect them legally. We protect them in other ways, but we also rescue individual animals. I'm just going to show you a video that kind of gives you a kind of a 2 minutes feel of what we do. So,
I want to help animals in distress, whatever the reason.
I want to stop the poaching.
I want to help rescue them when disaster strikes.
When they're orphaned, I want to be there for them.
I want to protect them from neglect and abuse.
I want to make a difference.
I found a way.
I found a way.
IFAW, protecting animals everywhere. Find us at ifaw.org.
You saw that people were mouthing something. I don't know why, but the words didn't come up. But it says, I found a way. And then I found a way is the initials of IFAW. What we do is, in all these offices, we have what we call the core campaigns, the core programs, where we all do. So all these 15 offices do this. And then each office, in addition to that, they do local campaigns or campaigns that are relevant to the area where they are. So these are our six major kind of programs: animal rescue, fighting wildlife crime, protecting elephants, defending whales, education, and helping dogs. I'm just going to talk a bit about them. Defending whales, we've been working on whales for quite some time. There are still some countries that have whaling: Iceland, Norway, Japan. Our main focus has been in Iceland because we're quite close, and the UK office has been more involved than any of the other office because we're also close than anybody else's. So we've been quite involved in the campaign in Iceland, but also in Japan. We have representatives in Japan. We have education as well, so we have everywhere we have offices, we try just to educate people of all ages. This is counts as education for us, just go to any colleges and tell what we do. We do have companion animals campaigns, and in some countries they are higher or more important than others. In particularly South Africa, we have a very strong project called CLAWS, where we help dogs and cats, and especially dogs, sterilization programs, readoption programs. So it's not just wild animals. Sometimes people think that we only deal with wild animals. We also have domestic animals. Elephants has been an important part of us. We have two offices in two countries in Africa, in South Africa and in Kenya. We've been relocating them, translocating them, creating corridors. There's a lot of active work in Africa, luckily, in both the French-speaking countries. Since we have French offices, we can do that with them, the English-speaking countries. And I've been in the Portuguese-speaking countries because I speak Portuguese, so they sent me there, which was quite interesting. And fighting wildlife trade, or wildlife crime in general, but specific wildlife trade. There are other organizations that do that, but we are one of the leaders on the wildlife trade in the internet. There's a lot happening in the internet, and we're kind of leading the research and the campaign to try to address the problem of wildlife trade in the internet. Actually, about two weeks ago, we launched the latest report in Parliament about our latest discovery in how big this trade is and how difficult it is to tackle. So it's one of the things we do quite close. And we do animal rescue. So every time there is a disaster, tsunami, an earthquake, anywhere in the world, we have teams that can go there, be deployed there, and just try to rescue the animals, help the animals. Sometimes people die not because of the earthquake. They die because they try to help their own pets. They won't leave them alone. And then if you don't put the animal into the equation, you can't really rescue people sometimes. And that's where we come and help as well. Right. So we do have loads of projects in, as I said, in many countries. So which sort of animals we cover? Well, I'll give you another video now that also give you an insight about which countries we are, which sort of animals and projects we are kind of covering all over the world. You see everything from wolves, penguins, not just the core animals that we just mentioned before, also all the projects, and it depends where you go. In fact, the first campaign that IFAW had was in Canada with the seals. You might have heard about IFAW related to seals, because that's how we started. IFAW was founded by a British person, Brian Davis, who went to Canada to campaign against the seal hunting there, created an IFAW there. Politically, it was very difficult for him to survive there. He was arrested so many times, he had to move to the US. And that's where IFAW headquarters is today. So it's in Cape Cod, still quite close to in Massachusetts, quite close to Canada. And headquarters are there. The second biggest office after the headquarters is ours. So the UK office is the second biggest. So we connected to the creation of IFAW because of the creator, because of the size of our office and other things. So what we do here, what we do in the UK. Well, we have, when you go to our website, that's what you will normally see. You will normally see the core campaigns I was telling you before, but then suddenly some other things that you won't see in the same website of other countries. You see badgers here and foxes there. So we deal with fox hunting, we deal with the badger cull, and that's what we're telling you today, what this part of our work. Internationally, we also lead, you know, on some things. For instance, in whaling, the UK office is we lead on all the communications that have to do with whaling, and also, as I said before, we are leading on the internet trade, wildlife trade. Our office leads on that. We also are an office that get more money from anybody else's. So most of the money that ends up in IFAW comes from the UK as well. So we are big in fundraising as well. And other people in my office deal with this, but I deal with the national work, which is divided in the ban of hunting with dogs, the opposition of the badger cull at the moment, and I need lobbying for a better national wildlife legislation, which is an ongoing project we always give up, never give up. So we're going to be telling you about this now. Let's start with the hunting. Sometimes I use this presentation when I go to other countries, and which they don't know much about what we do, and they have heard about the hunting arc, and they think, well, you just kill foxes. And I show them this, and I ask them, which of these animals you think that IFAW UK has a campaign trying to protect and has been campaigning for years? Which ones would you think?
All of them.
Yeah, quite correct. Well, not quite. All those that have a blue dot. There's one that hasn't, which is unfortunately the rabbits. Why? Because we work to protect the Hunting Act. And the Hunting Act is not a fox hunting issue. It's a mammal issue. Hunting Act protects all mammals, with the exception of rats and rabbits, that's why the rabbits are not here, be hunted with dogs, protect them from being hunted with dogs. So by protecting the hunting area, we are not just tackling the issue of hunting, they are tackling the issue of all possible mammals that might be attacked by a dog. But of course, some of these mammals are persecuting more than others, because these are people that have dedicated part of their lives to persecute them for generations and centuries. These particular sports or blood sports dedicated to persecuting. And of course, these are the ones that you already know, the fox, the hare, the stags, and the badgers. They all have these so-called blood sports that badgers, although they are protected for many centuries, there was badger baiting going on, and it still happens illegally. And of course, there's fox hunting, hare coursing, and stag hunting that before the Hunting Act were perfectly legal. And now, because there's still people breaking the law, they're still under threat. So these are the mammals that have been more persecuted. So therefore, we have paid a lot of attention trying to help them. So let's talk about the Hunting with Dogs campaign that we do here. As I said, it's all about fox hunting, stag hunting, hare coursing, and also mink hunting. People sometimes forget about the minks. Mink hunting is an organized hunt as well. Used to be a hunt that used to hunt otters. It was the otter hunts, which in 73, I think, was made illegal, and they switched from otters to minks because their habitat is similar, the hounds also similar. You see, they're quite different type of hounds, the ones used in mink hunting. All that was banned with the Hunting Act. For those that are not very familiar about how hunting with dogs looks like, I'll just give you a short clip. It's basically, as you know, with a pack of hounds, people mounted or not. In some areas in the UK, they are not mounted, like in Cumbria or in Wales sometimes. Some of them are dressed in red, and they tend to be the huntsman or the whippering or the master. They're in charge. Others behind, they're just following. They call the field. And the hounds find the scent. This is a scent-based hunt. They find the scent of the fox or the hare. They find this line. They create this line that is just creating there. When they find it, they don't bark. They cry. That's the term. They cry. Hounds, all the breeds of hounds, produce this distinctive sound, which is called cry. And that's how the huntsmen know that they found a scent. And then there's a chase that lasts for hours. The fox might go underground, and then a terrierman might be called to use a terrier to force the fox out, so the whole chase continues. Or if it doesn't go out, and it's called bolting the fox out. If it doesn't go out, then dig it out and shoot it on the spot. The main thing is not the death of the fox. The main thing is the chase. This is what the whole hunting is all about. That's why sometimes they could kill it, but they just want to chase it a bit more, so they make it run a bit more. And that was essentially what was banned. Many people that is not very familiar with the hunting ban, they think it's the legal part of it is killing a fox. It's not, really. It's chasing a fox. This is the law that makes it illegal to chase a fox, because this is a law about a way of killing an animal as opposed to killing it or not killing it. I thought we do have, every time we address a campaign, we do have some sort of key principles list that we have to check whether these principles match the campaign we wanna run. So at one point in history, we kind of wondered whether we should go against this, should campaign against this. So this is the principle applied to this that we have, which is hunting of wild mammals. The ethical justification for hunting wild mammals must be considered on a case-by-case basis. Of course, that's to accommodate indigenous hunting that might happen in places like North Pole and places like that. Wild animals should not be hunting where there is an ethical or conservation concern. In this case, fox hunting in itself is not a conservation concern because the population of foxes is not threatened, but the population of hares is in some areas, so in there is a conservation concern, but definitely there is an ethical concern, because chasing an animal for a long time to kill it, that's not ethical. As you know, animal protection has advanced over the years, and although animals are still being used and are still being killed, the modern society will try to do is minimize the suffering of the animal if it has to be killed. And part of that, including in abattoirs, is to reduce the time between the animal being stressed and the animal being killed. Well, this doesn't really follow any of these rules. This is the opposite. Just make it that long chase that lasts forever and then kill it afterwards. So that long chase creates an unnecessary suffering, which is why this is unethical. And this is why IFAW campaigns against it, and this is why the Hunting Act was passed. So the Hunting Act was passed on the basis of chasing a wild mammal is unethical. Right. a bit of a history of the hunting and how everything happened. There've been in the UK many laws that we call them Lagmar laws, because they have changed the paradigm, they have changed the landscape in the world. Laws that were passed here first and then our country started to imitate us, they changed the way we deal with the world. And because we need it, one of the worst countries in history in terms of animal abuse is the United Kingdom, or England in particular, more than the United Kingdom. For centuries, we were known as the worst people dealing with animals. People that wanted to see animals being tortured would come to England to see badger baiting, bullfighting. Bullfighting was invented here. Badger baiting was invented here. Bear baiting was invented here. And every time that you see it in another country, it was exported from the British. They went there and exported. We were the worst possible country in animal abuse for centuries, which generated the best possible people trying to stop it. So for years, there was this clash. And something happened in Europe in the 17th century, the Enlightenment, the 18th, 17th century, which was this movement where people start to stop, think, and realize that traditions are not necessarily something that you have to keep. You can reflect, you can see if things have changed, you can put new values into society. And that phenomenon, the Enlightenment, worked better in some countries than others. And in the UK, worked very well. A lot of new intellectuals realized this is outrageous, we can't keep doing this. And campaigns started to be created, and organizations started to be created. The RSPCA was created by the same person that was campaigning against slavery, because it was the same concept, William Wilberforce. And eventually, in 1835, there was a ban of bear, bull baiting, and dog fighting in the same law. So something had been so traditional in the UK for centuries was banned. And this was really a landmark piece of legislation, which is still, we have the same ban. That's why bullfighting is common in Spain, because when it was banned in the UK, the people that wanted to see bullfighting didn't know where to go. And because at that time, Gibraltar became British, many of the British people that went down south exported the bullfighting country. And so bullfighting is now big in Spain, or not anymore, but used to be big, because we banned it here, but others took it over. But before that, Britain was the bullfighting country number one in the world. And of course, not that later, 1849, cockfighting was banned. And then there were a few other blood sports, fox hunting and badger baiting. And organized campaigns against these hunting sports started quite early in 1923. That's when the League Against Cruel Sports was created. And success were achieved after a few years. In 1878, otter hunting was banned, which was good. And then the otter hunters moved to minx hunt. And IFAW joined this campaign in 1989. So we kind of been doing this for quite some time. Of course, the League has done it for longer than us. But we joined for some time just to help to achieve this goal. And of course, eventually, there was a ban of hunting with dogs in 2004. So we consider all these laws landmark pieces of legislation. And none of them are perfect. None of them are unchangeable. They can be improved. They can be, but they are so important. I was involved, that's where I met Tori. I was involved in anti-bullfighting campaign for many years. And you might have heard the Catalonia banned bullfighting. And I was involved in that campaign as well. And I use the Hunting Act as one of the main arguments to ban bullfighting in Catalonia, in the sense that if Britain managed to create this law, after all this tradition, you can do it too. And that was always connected, this sort of thing. So they're important laws because they have far more effect than you think internationally. So this is how we looked at our initial campaigns, with a kind of very crude leafleting. Basically, we had a battlefield with two sides. One is the Countryside Alliance, which had been the organization kind of representing the hunting interest. And then at the last few years of the campaign against hunting, three big organizations got together, IFAW, the League Against Cruel Sports, and the RSPCA, and in this coalition campaign to protect hunted animals, which kind of was the last push to get the Hunting Act happening. Because we worked together, kind of we achieved it. I'm going to give you some of the political dimension of this. Traditionally, conservatives have been always linked to pro-hunting people, while the Labour has been linked to anti-hunting people. I said traditionally because it's not doesn't need to be like this forever. It's actually kind of changing already from inside the Conservative Party. There are many conservatives now that they are anti-hunting. So it's a good change. And our campaign was kind of, the last few years, kind of high profile in Parliament with lots of buses and balloons, all sort of things we've been doing. And of course, we have a lot of stuff, animals that we can dress. IFAW is very good in dressing animals. As you can see, very realistic. And we don't waste any opportunity. Every time we can just go and dress and play instruments, we do it. And of course, we did it. And of course, the other side of their own campaigns as well. The hunters, they also campaigned to defend hunting with all sort of kind of graphic imagery and sometimes quite violent demonstrations, sometimes quite big demonstrations. This, I'm not saying that was violent, that was really quite big in number, but this is quite violent, just leaving a dead body of a horse and saying all the horses will end like this. It happened in Brighton. And physically violent in front of the parliament the few weeks before the ban was passed, as you might remember if you were involved. And many, very defiant, they will say, we're going to break the law, even if you pass this law. So from the very beginning, there was obviously an indication that this ban would not just happen and everything will be fine. It will be difficult to implement. But it happened. What did we do when we have a big success at IFAW? We just dress as animals and celebrate. And so that's what we did. So just went and drink a bit of champagne and things like that. Kind of lasted a short period of time because hunting continued. Why continue? Well, many hunts defied the law. They said, no, it's just not going to do it. How they did it? They started to develop alibis, started to try to look at the laws, whether they could use some of the exemptions, exploit and abuse some of the exemptions. But they actually created an alibi called trail hunting. You might have heard about trail hunting all the time. You might have heard hunters saying, we are not breaking the law anymore, we're doing trail hunting. And police saying it, and politicians saying it, and CPS saying it. What we are saying, that trail hunting doesn't exist. Trail hunting, if it exists, is actually a false alibi. It's not a sport, because it didn't exist before the Hunting Act. That was created with the Hunting Act. There were other things that did exist before. Drug hunting, bloodhounds hunting. These things, they were really cruelless. There were no prey. There were artificial scents being followed, or in the bloodhounds, it's a person being followed. But the hunts didn't convert to drug hunting or blood sport or bloodhounds. They created trail hunting that looks like hunting, but it's not hunting. They don't use artificial scents like drug hunting, which is aniseed scents. They use fox bases scents. They don't tell the huntsman where the scent goes, so there's sometimes accidents. So they created something that would make enforcement so difficult that the consequences is enforcement is very difficult. So it's a very successful alibi they created that we need to stop to be used again, because without this, we'd have been so many more persecutions than there have been. They also started to hide, to hunt in places that were private before they could hunt in many other places. So definitely the areas where they used to hunt before, they were bigger than the ones they use now. Therefore, from that point of view, there are fewer foxes being hunted because there are areas where they don't go close. But also they tried to block the access to any witness, etc. They rely on law enforcement from the police and the CPS. They hope that nobody's going to enforce it. And they were quite right in many places, the police or the CPS. They were not much interested about it. And if they are caught, it's just a fine. There's no prison or anything like that. So they said, well, so what? We play the fine. And they hoped that the Hunting Act would be repealed, because from the day one, the Tory party said, we will repeal this act if we get into power. So that all explains why there was this defiant element of it. So of course, we were just ready to change campaign and do something else, and realize, well, we can't just stop. We got Hunting Act, but now this is not really working. What do we do? So we started doing two things. Work on the enforcement of the Hunting Act. This is obviously the problem, is the enforcement, it's not the act, so let's work on that. And also if they try to repeal it. Defend the hunting ban and work in enforcement. So this is the two dimensions of the work since 2004, which is 2005, which is the time that Hunting Act was activated. So first we started to monitor hunts. These were our first two monitors, Kevin and Pete, which started to observe the hunts in order to gather evidence to see whether they were breaking the law or not with an attempt to prosecute them. Develop prosecution, if there were enough evidence. We managed to get a prosecution early on hair coursing. Hair coursing is far easier to prosecute because the Hunting Act makes illegal many aspects of hair coursing, such as even attending a hair coursing event is illegal. So we managed to get some prosecution on that, and so the hair coursing, organized hair coursing, has really been reduced compared to as it was before. But fox hunting and axe hunting, and that was far more difficult. We started helping the police to understand the difference between legal hunting and illegal hunting, just training them, because of course the police had no idea about these sort of things. And lobbying, continue lobbying, defending a hunting ban all the time. What's the situation today? Well, as you know, in the last election, the Conservative Party had a manifesto which already included, as it had been included before, a pledge to repeal the Hunting Act. So that threat was always there. But of course, they didn't win. They had to negotiate power with the Liberal Democrats. And because the Liberal Democrats, part of them are pro-hunts, others are not, so it's kind of not that black and white like the Tories. Therefore, negotiations started. And they ended up in the coalition agreement with this sentence: "We will bring forward a motion on a free vote enabling the House of Commons to express its view on the repeal of the Hunting Act." This is, in other words, it's saying we're going to vote about whether we vote on the Hunting Act. It's a kind of dividing the vote into. Rather than saying we're going to vote on repealing, we're going to vote whether we should vote on repealing. So it's kind of dividing the whole vote. So the threat is there. It's just a bit milder now. Rather than a single vote, it will happen in two. But it's a real threat of the repeal of the Hunting Act, so we've been aware. So when is it going to happen, this? Well, it could happen next year, the next, or never. Why hasn't it happened yet? Because they don't have the votes. The Tory party, as I said before, is not the same Tory party it used to be. So there are many Tories don't want hunting. And there's a group inside, it's called a Conservative Against Fox Hunting, who are opposed to fox hunting and opposed to the budget cull. They're also known as the Blue Fox. And they have been campaigning internally in the Tory party. So many MPs are on their side. So now if you try to have a vote right now, we would win it. That's why they haven't tried to have that vote, because they would lose it. But next elections, next year, might change this. So we might have the whole thing straight away after the elections, or not, or might never happen. Depends who wins the elections. Depends how big this dissident group internal of the Tory party gets. So it's all there in the open. Right. So what are the problems that we're facing at the moment? Well, we have not enough prosecutions on hunting offences nationwide to make the Hunting Act to have a strong deterrent effect. There are many allegations of illegal hunting, not enough investigations, not enough prosecutions. So that's bad. So that's why we've been trying to change, get more prosecutions on. As I said before, hunts have developed a very sophisticated alibi, sometimes linked to exemptions of the act, sometimes trail hunting. And they've been successful in the sense that they've stopped prosecutions that should have been successful. In general, although it varies from country to country, police forces have hunting at the lowest of priorities. And as you know, they always, and recently even more, say that they don't have enough resources, they don't have enough money, they don't have enough staff. Therefore, things have to be prioritized, and hunting always goes at the bottom of the pile. There are particular counties where this is worse than others. There are countries where there have been many allegations of illegal hunting, and yet very few or weak response from the police or the CPS. And in generally, West Country, where we are now, tends to be one of these. We've been working many years in Dorset. IFAW has been concentrating a lot of work in Dorset because it's one of these. It's one of the counties with many, many allegations and no prosecutions at all. When I joined IFAW about 2 years and a half ago, not a single prosecution had been achieved yet in Dorset. So neither the police or CPS in these countries, such as Dorset, were particularly proactive. So when I joined it, I worked for the League Against Corruption for a few years. I got the first successful prosecutions when I was there. Then I left and did the bullfighting stuff. I worked on other issues. And then a couple of years ago, we realized, well, in Dorset, still no single prosecution. The IFAW's approach didn't seem to work. So then I joined in the team and tried to refresh it to see. But I really faced kind of a situation that was akin of mission impossible, really. Because how are you going to solve this? How are you going to get a prosecution if you have the police and the CPS not really helping you? You don't have enough money to do private prosecutions all the time. So, well, we found a way to address it. What we did is change the way that hunts were monitored. We created what we call the enhanced monitoring techniques. We changed everything. We changed the method we did it. I can't tell you many details, because if I tell you all the logistical details and tactical details, this is going to be in YouTube, and then people might know. But I can tell you some of it. For instance, we use professional wildlife crime investigators. Often, monitoring was based on volunteers, sometimes subs or ex-subs to becoming monitors. We have used them in the past, but we gradually started to get professional investigators from other fields and just get them into the team. We call them wildlife crime investigators. Get the best possible equipment, just see what works, and just get the best possible cameras, the best possible equipment. We work with a lot of covert over operations, which means we often, some monitors groups, they are very close and very open, just follow the hands and just with the camera. We don't, we hide. So we basically are covert operation most of the time, sometimes for a long distance, observing the hand so they don't know we're there in kind of sophisticated camouflage. And sometimes it becomes over if we need to get the faces of the offenders, if we have enough evidence and we need still to ID. So it's a combination of covert and over. We also do a lot of forensic analysis. We don't just produce videos. We process the videos. We enhance the videos. We enhance the hand. And I have experience in all this field, so that's what I personally do at IFAW. And when we present cases to where we present them, we present now very sophisticated files, we call them. So it's not just the footage. We have already developed the case. We have analyzed the case. We've done all the work that the police would do, so there's no excuse to say we don't have the time. And we can choose to give it to either the police or the RSPCA. So go to the public route, the police CPS route, or the RSPCA, that they have their own investigators and their own prosecutors as well. So that is our choice, depending where we are. So we started doing this when I joined it. Kind of took some time to train the new people, get new people. Of course, the hands realized what we were doing. So they reacted. So every time there's a tactic, there is a counter-tactic. So this is the kind of thing we faced when we started.
Where are we? You're smacking the map, you are. I don't care if you're filming.
Thank you.
So it became very difficult even to get close to them. So they did as much as they could. If we had 10 people there, they would have 100 people trying to find us. They would spend hours trying to find us and trying to tell everyone where we were, blocking vehicles. So it really was difficult. But we didn't give up. We just kept trying, find contractors, and eventually we had a good case. We thought we had it. We thought, this might work. We did all the forensics with this, and we developed it. And this is how we present the case. We present the case with sophisticated PowerPoint presentations, with animations. In this case, we presented to the RSPCA. We decided to choose the RSPCA route for a prosecution. And everybody involved, you see there's a star there for a huntsman, another the yellow for the master, and we basically describe in animations where everything happens. It's almost like you had a satellite there chasing everything with all the information that you would need to get the prosecution, the order of sequence of events. This is a fox, then some counts. Went this way, a person called number three, which is the follower number three, cross over there, then more hounds went, then the follower number two joined it, then the other follower, then the huntsman came in, and then he crossed the the fox, etc. So it's very detailed way we present the cases in order to make them compelling and to show that we exactly know what happened. Despite we've been blocked, we kind of started to move away. And sometimes we actually recording information from 2 or 3 or 4 miles from whatever is happening because our equipment now allows us to do it, and etc. So these are just examples for you to see how we operate. This is the actual footage of this prosecution. Just show you a little bit of it, which is the key one. So it was the 7th on hand last year. The RSPCA was prosecuting Mr. Parker, who was the huntsman of the 7th on hand. And this is the first shot of a fox crossing a fence. So we know that there was a fox over there. And then that's it. There was nobody for a while, but then there was somebody here with a horse, obviously made a sound because make somebody coming running from the other side. This person over there, one of the hand supporters, and there's another hand supporter coming over there. Is what you saw before in the map, the sequence of events, and there will be hounds coming over here now, and trying to find the scent. The fox has gone through here. They haven't found the scent yet. There's that hand supporter going down. The hound's going towards the area where the scent was. Turns, might not have got it right, but now they have other hounds here. They do go through the area where the fox went, remember, went through here. And when they find the scent, they all go very quickly. They find the scent. Okay, they're going online, it's called, but this one is off. And the others get distracted by this one. What are you doing here? So they just gone back. That's one of the other supporters that's coming here. They both been pointing towards there. Why should you point if you're following artificial scent? He's pointing. There's no artificial scent. Doesn't look like anything. What they pointed about. And the huntsman appears here. And they open the gate. And he points again. How can you point to an artificial scent again? I repeat. And then he engages, and we did forensics of the sound, and you could hear from 2.5 miles the sound of the horn. And you can, now he's using it, and the whole hounds go and chase a couple of fields, etc. So we thought that was a good case. So he was, the first hearing was the 12th of September 2013, and that's Mr. Parker. And the evidence was so compelling. He just gave the towel straight away. He pleaded guilty straight away. He could not defend, which is quite unusual in hunting cases because they throw everything they have. So we knew we were into something. Our method works. We can't just, despite all the obstacles, and we can't just present a case that's so compelling that they throw the towel. So we kind of continued developing this. It went to the press. It was quite well documented. And I like this particular one that says, new high-tech frontier in hunt battle, so I like that one. It was only a penalty of money, it's only £500, which is quite a lot in hunting cases. Normally it's far less than that. The maximum is 5,000, but they all play, always say they have minimal wage, so then the judges takes it lower. Of course, when you prosecute somebody higher than a huntsman, like a master, then you can get more. And the Heathrow case that the RSPCA took, that was one of the highest penalties because there was also a corporate case, the whole hunt was found guilty. But we were quite happy about the method. And that was, remember, I said before, we're working in two lines, two dimensions here. One is the enforcement, but also the protecting the band if there's any threat. And there was a threat last year. There was an attempt to weaken the hunting act. They wanted to change and amend one of the schedules in order to allow more than two dogs to be used in one particular schedule, the flashing transit section, which would have made enforcement almost impossible. So we had to react very quickly. We heard it before anybody else. It was a rumor. We mobilized anything. And this is what we did. Everything we had. We leaflets, everything, and it worked. So the government eventually said, we can't possibly do that. They don't have the support of the Liberal Democrats, which just went through heavily, that they announced in Parliament that they could not do that change. Of course, the threat is not gone because they could do it again, they could try to do it again. But they were planning to do it very quickly without nobody realizing it by the back door. And we just ruined their plans by making this big thing. And so they could not do it quickly by the back door, and therefore they lost support. So this is another example of what we do on the hunting campaign. Badges, let's go and talk about badges. The badger campaign, of course, started where there was a threat of the badger cull, which started a few years back. What's the problem? Well, many of you already know a lot about this. Some of you might not, so I kind of want to spell it a little bit for those that not. But we have a bovine TB issue, bovine tuberculosis. It's bovine, it's a specific tuberculosis for cattle. They are the type of tuberculosis, or the species of this bacterium, Mycobacterium bovis, is one. This other Mycobacterium that is not bovis, which created an epidemic, and this is how it has been growing, which started in the west and southwest. It's going to be moving up. So it's definitely an epidemic. It's affecting cattle, which is transmitted in different ways, often from cattle to cattle. And sometimes it does get to humans, but it's rare. You don't get it by drinking milk and things like that if it is treated. And it's also affected on animals. This line here represents the wild of reservoir, which is not necessarily only at badgers. Could be any mammal could technically have it. Could be deer, could be other badgers. But very soon, there was this blame to the badgers. The badgers is responsible for this. While it could, as I said, could be anything. I put a question mark there, because the debate of the badger cull is quite old now. We've been talking about it forever. But the actual proof that the badgers have something to do with this hasn't really been materialized. A lot of speculation. These connections, correlations, all this does exist. But the fact that they are the blame part of it, I mean, you see, this is a very tiny bit here, a very big picture. And many research shows that if there is a connection, it's very weak. So the question mark hasn't been eliminated. It's still there. But there are solutions. There's an epidemic, there's a bacteria, there's cattle suffering. What can we do? There are loads of solutions we can do. Improve biosecurity. So, okay, if there is a connection between wildlife, any type of wildlife, and cattle, let's make that barrier between them bigger. That's what biosecurity means. Reduce the cattle movements, because that's how they pass the disease from one to another. Just reduce them, control them. Vaccinate cattle. This is in development, hasn't been developed, but of course that was the ultimate solution. Once the cattle is vaccinated, that problem is completely gone. And better test cattle, because sometimes if you find out that the cattle is infective, you have less of a chance that you're going to infect somebody else's. So better test, more regular tests, do them more often. If there is a connection with wildlife, then vaccinate wildlife. That's another way to deal with it. All these things could be done. Of course, others say that there are more things that could be done. You can kill all the cattle. That's another thing you could do. And also kill all the wildlife, whoever you blame at that particular time. So they are all potential solutions. Some of them seem far more sensible and effective than others. In paper, if you do research, you'll find out that also, in fact. But somehow, the government become particularly obsessed with this one, culling badgers. So there was research done a few years back in the Labour government in trying to see, is it true? Is it true that badgers are so responsible for this? So for 10 years, they spent a lot of millions doing research, comparing areas where badgers were culled and areas where badgers were not culled to see whether there was an effect in the incidence of the disease. And these are called, these researchers call randomized badger cull trials, RBTC. And it showed that the effect of culling badgers only had an improvement of 16%. So if you do cull badgers and cull loads of them, at least 70% of them, the maximum improvement you can get to the epidemic is 16%. It's actually 16% reduction of the increase. It's not just 16% of the disease animals. The disease gets higher every year. Now, if you kill them, next year will get higher 60% less than you would have done otherwise. So that's a tiny thing. Therefore, the scientists that ran this concluded that culling badgers doesn't contribute significantly in any way in a reduction of bovine TB. So that was settled. Yeah, badgers are affecting, they are influenced, they have disease, but it's not, culling doesn't really solve it. Okay, done. So therefore, now the government will say, let's not cull them, and that's all right, because we have so many other things we can do. But not. This man came along, Owen Paterson, who often said he had a badger pet somewhere in his life. Perhaps he got traumatized somehow with his pet in one way or another, because he seemed very determined to just say, badger calling still is viable. Not just value, it's one of the most important things we have to do, and let's spend a lot of money in doing it, which make no sense. But that make all of us, the animal protection organizations in the UK, stop having the cup of tea we're having at the moment and said, we need to get together because this is outrageous. How is that possible? So the anti-badger cull campaign started. How we started? Well, we opposed to it because for two grounds, animal welfare and conservation. We opposed because animal welfare, obviously, you're killing animals and many are healthy animals, but also conservation, because in some areas you might actually kill all the badgers, so you might have local extinctions if you're not careful. And also, it can make it worse. If you're only thinking in the cattle and from an animal welfare group, you can make the whole disease worse. How? Well, this is the best way to explain it, with a phenomenon called perturbation, which is over there. This is what happens when you kill badgers. You have an area where they are infected, in red, and an area outside they are not infected. Then you kill all the ones that are infected, so you have fewer left. So it's an empty space there, which makes all the badgers from the child go in. And then these ones don't like the ones that come in, so there's a lot of interaction, some go in and out, some of the ones that go in and are going out, so we're spreading, you're spreading the disease. Otherwise, badgers are very territorial, they don't move from place to place, they stay there. If you do this, you make them move, and if there's anyone, even if it's only a tiny proportion, that is infected, you make the disease worse, called perturbation. And it was proven in that 10 years research, it was proven that when you do that, in the areas around the areas that you cull, the percentage of infected cattle increases, doesn't decrease. So the 16% that I showed you before is a combination of how much they decrease in here and how much increase in there. Altogether, that's 16%. So you can make it worse. IFAW, again, as I said before in the hunting, have to check every time we do a campaign whether it fits our principles. Can we do a campaign against this? Let's see. Cull of animals, what does our principle say? In case where a population reduction of animals is proposed and justified on a scientific and ethical basis, already they're not justified from a scientific basis, alternatives that do not involve killing animals or taking them into captivity are preferable on economic, ethical, scientific, educational, and other grounds. So if you have to do something, don't kill it. That's the idea. In circumstances where lethal control is deemed absolutely necessary and all other solutions have been exhausted, remember all these others, they haven't been exhausted yet, animals will be killed in the manner that minimizes the pain and suffering. And the manner that the government wanted to use was free shooting, which was not a controlled vet scenario with a lethal injection, was going with a gun and shooting at night. The least humane way. That's what we said. The government said, no, it's going to be quite humane. And then there was a debate. And then they said, well, let's test it. But anyway, because we don't feel it's scientific, science points towards not culling, because we don't feel that it's humane, because the method is inhumane, we oppose. So we joined the campaign, as everybody else did. And the first thing we did, we created Team Badger. So every organization that was involved with this created this Team Badger. It's about 25, many of them. We are there, SAFE, the RSPCA. It's one of the biggest animal protection organizations, coalitions. All right. Yeah, you're there. Yeah, we're all there, careful wild. And one of the first things we did is this big billboard with all our logos there. These are the times that we had time to do all these things. And came the photo opportunity. By the way, this is Philip Mansbridge, who used to be the CEO of Care for the Wild. Now he's our director. He moved to us. So the UK director, new UK director, 5 weeks in the post, is Philip. And I there. We went to rallies, it's in Bristol, and we got together and mobilized ourselves, political lobbying here, there, kind of animal costumes again, so took them again, and they were, of course, supporting our campaign as we did. And among other things, what IFAW did is work quite close with the big march that happened in London. There have been demonstrations all over the place, but in London, since we're based in London, we kind of helped a lot. We kind of helped to produce the mask. We were there, many people were there, quite successful. We were there in mass, the animals, of course, in mass. And this is our previous director, Robbie, which was one of the organizers of the march, and we had all the proper photos, number 10, given a petition, etc. OK, Okay, that seemed to work. We mobilized the public. The public seemed to be against this. Scientists also seem to be against this, so we're getting everything right at the moment. Let's get something more to show the government. It's not just a few demonstrators, not a few thousand. Let's show them hundreds of thousands of people opposed to this. Let's get this e-petition. So these e-petitions, as you know, is something that the government has created. So when you reach a particular number of signatures, actually 100,000, then this has to be voted in Parliament. So first target, 100,000. So we started to campaign. Let's go and sign, do this, sign, because we're going to reach it. We did it, reach it, good. They thought, well, that's it. We had a lot of time. Should we just try to do the next record? Let's break the record of the biggest ever petition, petition ever. See whether we can get the highest possible number. So we can continue just saying, keep signing. That was the number, 258,000. And we broke the record. So, okay, let's see what's next. Let's see whether we can achieve 300,000. And we kept campaigning and more and more and more. And we got 300,000. So eventually that's the end result because it has a deadline. And the end result was 303,000. So we kind of show everybody's with us, the public's with us. So surely now the government is going to say, well, if the science is against us and the public is against us, let's not do it. But no, they just carry on doing it. So they began with two pilot calls in 2013. One in Somerset, one in Gloucester, in these two areas, with the idea to try to prove that this method is humane. They said, well, we're going to say, do two pilots, and we're going to prove, or we'll try to prove, or assess, in a way or another, whether it's an effective way to reduce the population as we wanted. They have a target of 70% of the budget that had to be killed in those two areas, whether it's a humane way, and whether it's a safe way. These are the things they had to check. Theoretically, if you do a pilot, the idea is, if it doesn't work, then you don't do it anymore. So if you prove that the things that you wanted to prove were wrong, then you don't do it anymore. So we thought, well, possibly that might be the end of it. So, but very soon we realized, well, now how are we going to help? We've done all the campaigning thing, we've done all the signature thing, we've done the lobby thing. So what's the next thing? Let's help people on the ground, people that go and help them on the ground. So the wound budget patrols were created in Gloucester and Somerset with people just trying to witness what was going on, but also trying to help any budget that might be injured and might not be completely dead, to either cure it or help it to die more peacefully. But in a way, just be there, be aware, see whether somebody's breaking the rules, whether the license conditions have been broken, get evidence of that. So we went, when the whole thing has started, and joined one of them and make a video of it, which is this. I'm going to show you part of it. No,
I'm leaving the office right now. It's 3:30. It's very early, but I'm not going home. I'm going to Gloucester because today I'm going to participate in a wounded badger patrol. This is part of the badger cull. Something I've never done before. Something that almost nobody has done before. See how it looks like.
Hi, I'm Jordi from IFAW.
Hello.
Hi. Hello.
Jordi from
Hi.
Hello. Your legs.
Sorry, what?
Yes, hello. 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 Hello.
I'm Jordi.
Jordi. So
I'm from IFAW, International Fund for Animal Welfare. Just coming to have a look, and I'm going to be recording a little bit, so I'm going to create a YouTube video to promote the whole thing.
Brilliant, brilliant.
So.
But first of all, thank you so much everyone for coming, because it's amazing we've had people out, haven't we, every night from basically the 1st of June, and even though things haven't started yet, I think it's making a really, really powerful point that we all feel really strongly it's not going to help BTB, it's not going to help the cows or the farmers. It wouldn't be possible to happen there because they'd have so much land. Because they've got to have 70% of the land signed up in order to cull in an area. So they created Stroud 100 and they had massive success with that. We've got some really amazing supporters, people like Vince Dale, who owns Ecotricity. He signed up all his land. I think maybe.
That was the first, yeah, that was kind of the beginning. So we were hoping to promote this so people could join them. So we produced a video so people could see, well, this is not a dangerous thing. This is kind of anybody can do it. It's all ages and you don't need to know anything particular. It seems relaxed enough. And so to encourage people to go there. We also started to train people that went there in the skills of gathering evidence, since we had all these skills developed with the hunting campaign. We thought, well, if you do find something, then you want to be believed. You just don't want to say, I saw somebody shooting in at a distance that is against the rules, and police say, no, we don't believe you. You want to gather evidence, and we have to, it's the same situation in the hunting. You have to gather evidence, what we call in hostile conditions, in conditions where people don't tend to believe you. So they were transferable skills. So we started to kind of go and train in wouldn't budget patrols, give them cameras, we lend them cameras, we lend them GPSs, so they started to be able to respond if they needed to. So that's part of how we were help logistically. So the first year of the pilots ended in mid-October, and the idea was to reach 70% of the population. That's what should have been killed, about 5,000. However, they didn't reach the target by the time of the 6 weeks ended, so the government decided to extend the period, 2 weeks in one area and 8 weeks in the other, in Gloucester's 8 weeks, in order to reach the target. So obviously it was not working from the government point of view. And the idea was, if that was successful, they would extend the pilot in up to 4 years, so you do that every year, and then at one point roll it out to other areas in the country where the culling was deemed necessary. So starting in two areas during 4 years and then start to move it to our areas. So what was the result of this? Well, remember that if all that works from the point of view of the government, the maximum you can achieve is just an improvement of 16% of the increase, a reduction of the 60% of the increase of the disease. So all this for such a small result. But anyway, there was some hope there because the government had set this, an independent expert panel, a group of people theoretically independent from the government that would look at all the data of the pilots and would tell us the answers to the three questions. Whether it's humane, whether it's efficient, and whether it's safe. So they did got the data, and in the papers came out something like that. Budget cull were ineffective and failed humane tests. So the independent panel said it's not humane at all and it's not efficient at all. It's not efficient because they didn't get the target even with the extension of 8 weeks and 2 weeks. About 80% is what they got all together. They had to reach 70%. And it was not humane because the criteria they used to assess humane, it was if more than 5% of the population of animals that died took more than 5 minutes to die, that's inhumane. And that's what they come out. So it was between 6.4 and 18%. So definitely more than 5%, but in the worst possible scenario, a lot more than 5%. So this is the amount of badgers that die for a quite painfully. So, and it was quite expensive. So it was obviously not effective and not humane. The only thing they said that was safe. But obviously, 2 out of 3, we thought, that's it, that's the end. A pilot that tells you it did not work. And any pilot that tells you it did not work, you stop whatever you were trying. And even the government advisor was advising now against it. So there were people that prior to this point were either in defense or pro-cull. They started to say we're anti-cull. So they were losing people supporting it. The good thing that did happen is that with this result, the idea of rolling out to other areas had to be postponed. So the government could not possibly say, yeah, it failed, therefore we're going to extend it everywhere. So that was stopped. That's a success from a campaigning point of view. They did stop it. But they were not just saying, well, let's stop altogether. They stopped the rolling out. So they wanted to carry on the pilots, change a little bit the numbers, change a little bit the targets to make it more likely that next year you're going to get into targets, but at least not roll it out yet. So we, of course, we and everybody else kept campaigning. We just got blocks one after the other, all kind of basically kind of mesmerized about what's going on, all the information's in our side, what's happening. We even went to the parliament and had votes, and the MPs voted for us. So the politicians voted against the cull. Okay, we have the scientists, the politicians, the general public, the wildlife presenters, David Attenborough, everybody was there, and still not happening. They still go ahead. Not the end of the story, fiasco, not the end of the story. The black and white issue is turning all of us gray because we kind of couldn't believe that was going on. And then the other thing that we tried, okay, it seems that this is not going to go away. Let's develop one of those solutions that the government should have been developing and is not doing it. One of them is the vaccination of badgers. So the BAGVI was created, the Badger and Cattle Vaccination Initiative, which basically is a fund where people give money to, and then this money goes to badger vaccination projects, local or otherwise. And we got involved. Brian May kind of started this. We got involved as well. And then many badger vaccination projects started. We have some in here. And we just wanted to see if it works. And we did the same thing with the badger patrols. Badger patrols, we wanted to promote the idea. So with a video, let's go and film it, show how easy it is and how safe it is. So we did the same with the vaccination. We went with the Dorset Badger Vaccination Project. Dorset is the area we control more. And we just filmed it. And we showed, in order to show the people how it works.
How many jobs do you have left for this year?
We've got 11 jobs on, so we've got 7 left after this.
Yeah. And when did you get your accreditation? Last year?
Well, we did our course together in September, wasn't it?
September last year, yeah.
And all the jobs, they've been successful?
They've been very successful. We got more badges than we thought we were going to get. So, you know, hopefully we've got sort of probably at least 70% of the population that are living there, if not more.
This is day 13.
Of baiting in this particular site, so yeah. After 13 days,
yeah.
They've
sussed it.
Yeah.
Each stone is between 3 and 5 kilograms, which is what Avla reckon is shiftable by a badger, but nothing else.
Go and have a quick look, see how many badges we've actually got.
Yeah.
Then we'll come back to the vehicle, get the vaccine ready.
Why Dorset? Is Dorset a particular place for...
Dorset is potentially a hotspot for TB. We have a lot of dairy farms, a lot of beef farms, and we have a lot of badgers. And so basically by concentrating in Dorset, we can actually sort of start eliminating TB in this area. This project basically will be going on for another 4 years, but we need to basically cover the whole of Dorset. So it's a big job.
And you think if enough vaccination projects take place around, would not be a need to cull badgers anymore?
No, there's no need to cull badgers at all. If you cull badgers, then they perturbate, so the badgers basically spread, and any spread of animals then potentially will spread disease, because you're just taking those animals further and further away. But by vaccinating them, the badgers don't move, and we get herd immunity. We don't need to vaccinate every badger, and so we get herd immunity, and then TB basically doesn't become a problem within that set.
We had a longer version of this. This is just a short version. We had a 15-minute version which explains all the process of vaccination. So people can say, okay, I would like to do that. I can do that. And volunteer. And just go and join these groups and be trained. You have to be trained. You have to be credited, etc. And we explained all the process. Through this process, the government start to perhaps either realizing, well, this budget cutting is not solving anything, or generally thought from the beginning that they were going to do something like that. But at one point, they started to say, well, we're going to do some vaccination as well, not just you. So DEFRA decided to kind of develop a project to vaccinate in what is called the edge areas. So these are the areas in the map where the risk or the incidence of the disease change according to the intensity. This is the high area, where is the hot spots, where the disease is higher. That is the low area here, where the disease is lower, and this is this area where it's kind of in between. So the DEFRA said they would develop a vaccination, official vaccination project here. But basically what they said is, well, we're not going to do it, but if you do it, we give you half the money. So they would finance half the money of anybody that would do a vaccination project in there, but no money at all in here. So in the areas where there's more of a need, no, they want to cull them. So they want, the plan is to cull them in here, to vaccinate them in there, which makes no sense. You vaccinate in the areas where there is lower and cull them in the areas. So although it's good that they start to see vaccination as part of the solution, so we're not going to say don't do it. Yes, yeah, yeah. And of course, people that live here, it's good for them to have money from the government to do what they would do anyway. But of course, that's hardly the solution. And if you still carry on culling, you're not going to solve anything like that. So it's a move in the right direction. Of course, at one point, the cull completely stops. That has to be something that has to be developed properly and with money, perhaps the money they were planning to use in the cull for this. It's moving in the right direction, but it's not quite there, isn't it? So, first year has passed, and yeah, as they said, they would continue the second year, and they started the second year, 2014. So, the second round, too. Same areas, Gloucester and Somerset. There were attempts to stop it legally. So, because one of the things they did, remember before they had this independent expert panel that says that was inhumane. Of course, the government probably didn't like that much, that this independent panel said it was inhumane and was ineffective. So they decided to get rid of it. So now the second year, there is no independent panel at all. There's nobody independent checking if it's right or not. They said they're going to do their own inspections. They're going to do their own analysis. And some of us thought, that must be illegal. Surely it must be illegal. So there were challenges in court. The budget trust challenged the government on this issue. And there were demonstrations outside, and I went to one of them. So this is it.
Okay, this is another chapter of the infamous budget cull in England. Today I don't have to move that far. I'm still in London, so I need to go to another place in London. I need to go to the Royal Court of Justice. Because today there is a judicial review. Some of the organizations from Team Badger, which IFAW belongs to, have challenged the government because the government decided to carry on with the pilot calls, but to get rid of the independent expert panel, which we think is outrageous. Many things that people think is outrageous. So they challenged the government in court, and today is the first hearing. And it's going to be a demonstration outside, so I'm going to join them, as many people would like to join.
Is now being driven just to political face-saving measures.
If the judge finds in our favour today, and we do put in place an independent expert panel system again, it will cause no end of problems for the coal contractors in Gloucestershire and Somerset. They will have to think long and hard if they're going to go ahead with this policy. As Bill quite rightly said, the only reason they didn't want scrutiny, the only reason is because they know they can't deliver this disastrous policy if people are looking at what they're actually doing and sharing it with the rest of the world. It's not going to happen. And people say to me, what are the alternatives? What are we going to do for farmers and bovine TB managers? And actually, by taking cattle-based measures and tightening them down, you can really get on top of this disease. So annual testing of cattle, tighter cattle control movement, better biosecurity measures. You have taken the level of TB in cattle in Wales down by 48%, 48% in the last 5 years. And yes, they have gone forward in their areas where they have significant levels of TB with a badger vaccination programme. And that programme has proved very effective. They've been vaccinating over 1,300 badgers a year. Now you can be certain of the animals that were killed in Gloucestershire and Somerset last year, probably 90% plus had no TB whatsoever. We know that they actually did post-mortems on about 154 animals. And again, not one of those animals post-mortem had visible lesions. Otherwise it would have shown up in the reports and it would be designated as a TB carrier. So they were all clear once again. And then landowners actually paid an extra amount of money to test four of them, but they were completely certain carried TB. And only one of that four was found to have early stage of the disease. We can do a lot about protecting wildlife, we can do a lot about making this country we live in a better place, and we can do a lot to show the rest of the world that the caring, compassionate British people will stand up for wildlife and we will protect it. Thank you for coming here today. Thank you for showing your anger and support to us. The Badger Trust will keep fighting. The rest of the world will keep fighting. IFAW and all the other charities behind this campaign will. Please keep supporting us.
So they lost. So the court said, no, they don't really need an expert panel. They appealed. And the appeal court said, they don't really need an expert panel. So what's going on here? So we did, the whole thing has started. So last year, I went with the Wounded Badger Patrols in Gloucestershire. So I said, well, this time I have to go to the Somerset one. So I went to the Somerset one. I'm not going to show you the video, but it's again something. So it's, we went and helped them to promote, to ask people to join them. The second year of the pilot ended in the 20th of October, and we still don't know the results. So there is no independent panel, so all the results are internal. We still don't know. They might just say, we got the targets. They might say, we haven't got the targets, we're going to go ahead anyway. Or they might say, we haven't got the targets, we're going to stop the whole thing altogether. So it's all open there. So we kind of been pressuring to find out when that's happening. And could they might just do it over Christmas, because everybody's eating something and distracted. Just put the news in. So we all prepare. We have the three press releases for the three potential outcomes. Two sides are so disproportionate in terms of arguments. These are the people is against the cull. Is the general public, most independent scientists, all the governments, or some of the government scientific advisors themselves, most wildlife experts, most MPs, many police, even the police said this is a complete waste of money, many farmers, many government officials in DEFRA that work there, they just don't want to do that. They've just been forced almost to do that. All animal protection groups, many vets, and who is in favor of this? The National Farmers Union, which only represents 16% of the farmers. That is a very limited amount of farmers who want to do this. Most farmers don't. DEFRA Secretary of State, Patterson, with this obsession with badges they seem to have. Some government scientists, definitely, yes, and the British Veterinary Association leadership. Because initially, the British Veterinary Association said, yeah, we are in favor of the cull, but if the experts say that it's inhumane, then we'll reconsider. Well, the experts said it was inhumane, and we thought, well, they will reconsider. And they didn't reconsider. There was a leak about 4 days ago, 5 days ago, from an internal memo in the British Veterinary Association, in which they basically say, there's many vets in our association, we are unhappy how this leadership is being in favor of the cull, while many of us are against it, especially after the independent panel was scratched. So even now this should be changed, because, well, there still is the leadership, but even the association as such cannot be say that it's pro-cull, it's just the leadership. So look how many people here, how little people there. So, and the crazy thing is that there are many alternatives other than this, and that's the most crazy thing of all. Wales done it. Wales did use this alternative, didn't do culling at all, and they reduced the disease 48%. So it's not theory. Somebody in the same island with the same badgers and the same cattle and the same bacteria has done what we say works and has proven it works. So how is that possible that they still go ahead? But there was winning hope. And one moment we thought, that's it. That's it, because it's so bizarre. There must be something very personal here. So that was the hope. Cabinet reshuffle. Perhaps Patterson is going to go. And he did go. And we thought, that's it. We have the whole obstacle there. But another disappointment. So Liz Truss came out and said, well, I'll carry on with this. How is that possible? Well, there's another hope. That's the other hope. Okay, see what happens there. But at the moment, it is all in the air. That might happen. They might carry on with a cull and not extend it, mechanical cull, and roll it out. They might not do it. They might just do it to save face, and then if they lose elections, then the whole thing changes. It's all out in the air. So how can you help if you want to help in anything like that? Well, five very easy things to do if you want to help us to do this. One is follow us on Facebook. If you're on Facebook, go and follow us. If you're on Twitter, go and follow us. This is our Twitter handle, IFAWUK, at IFAWUK. Next thing, very easy to do. It's cheap, it's free. Share our messages. We put something on this, share it in Facebook. Retweet it in Twitter. That's very easy. You want to go and lobby, by all means. Contact your MPs, that's where they are there, for you to contact them. And tell them two things. One, get the hunting up properly enforced. Second, stop the badger cull. Very simple message. Some, they will say, yeah, I'm completely with you. Most of them, some not. You can also volunteer. To volunteer to any place that you can volunteer. And of course, we are in London, so it's not gonna be much help for us to come to London to help us. But there are groups here, like your group, badger vaccination projects, and there's one right here. So where they probably need volunteers, and they're probably quite happy for people to join them, to help them, to get into the courses, to vaccinate. There are always groups locally that might be working on British fauna, and they might need volunteers. Just do that, by all means. And support us, if you can. Support us in any possible way economically. This is our website. If you go to our website and you are very rich and you have all this money and you don't know what to do with it, you just click there and give it to us, and we'll use it for these sort of things. So it's not going to be wasted. And that's it. So thanks very much. And any question, I'm quite happy to answer